witnessing to the reality of Jesus Christ in your life. It's this inner reality that the Spirit of God is saying, you are a Christ follower. And if you realize the depth of what that means, that you are redeemed, that you're saved from your sins, that you're going to have eternity with Christ, like, how do we not wake up every day just absolutely filled with joy? Amen? By the way, do you get to talk back to Pastor Luke when he's preaching? Sometimes? Okay. All right. So Jesus, just think about this. Jesus is eternally and unyielding joyful. There's never a time that Jesus is not filled with joy. Jesus is never in a bad mood. Now the question is, are you ever in a bad mood? When my kids were growing up in Lake Mills, if they would wake up crabby, I would say, just so you know, you're choosing to be crabby. You don't wake up and choose to be crabby. I think there are things that Jesus grieves over. I think he grieves over our sin, how we destroy and hurt one another. I don't know if you've said this, if you noticed this during the pandemic, you know, just the craziness. Again, I live very close to the Twin Cities. Minneapolis, heard them in the news. And I would ask God, why do you put up with us? We are terrible. Your people, every one of us, is terrible. When you realize that, I think it gives you a perspective. I think he grieves over our loss and pain. I'm dealing with the guy in our new church plant. We just planted a church in October. And he and his wife are getting divorced. Like, never saw it coming. Terrible stuff. I'm dealing with guys in our police, in our, we actually planted a new church targeting first responders. Post-traumatic stress. Like, off the charts, just stuff that people have dealt with. And how do you step into that and remind them that they can have a relationship with Christ and they can combat that darkness and that depression? I think the other thing is that God knows what we need and knows our wants. And so that's not something that is mysterious to him. I mean, think of your own life, how God's perfect timing is always his perfect timing. Let me just remind you, COVID did not surprise God at all. Supply chain issues, do you think that surprised God? Gas prices, all that stuff that in our human perspective we're like totally distraught over and frustrated. And yet I think ultimately you can look at a plan that God may have in your life. I don't know what he has in your life, but I know what he has in my life. And again, you can choose to let the joy of Jesus be in you. And you can have this sense of finding joy when others may be missing it. So we're in the book of Philippians. Paul writes this letter. It's not a letter of correction. Usually when Paul, the Apostle Paul, is writing to the churches that he started and established, it was always with the perspective of correction. Hey, you're kind of missing the boat here. I've got to correct you with healthy, truthful theology. In this case, Paul is writing to the Philippians, and he's commending them, and he's reminding them, hey, it's about joy, it's about rejoicing. Whatever circumstance you have, you can have joy. So if you have your Bible, I know it's going to be on the screen, but Philippians 1, in verses 12 to 18, and this is what Paul is saying. He says, I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel, so that it has become known throughout the whole imperial guard and to all the rest that my imprisonment is for Christ. And most of the brothers, having become confident in the Lord by my imprisonment, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. Some indeed preach Christ from envy and rivalry, but others from goodwill. The latter do it out of love, knowing that I am put here for the defense of the gospel. And the former proclaim Christ out of selfish ambition, not sincerely, but thinking to afflict me in my imprisonment. So, I mean, he is like hitting this hard. What then, Paul says? Only that in every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is proclaimed, and in that I rejoice. Friends, whatever circumstance you have, I don't care if you're in school, you work at a school, you're retired, every walk of life, people are watching you. They see how you respond to the trials, the tribulations, the traumas that you may experience. And what are you broadcasting? What are you proclaiming about Christ and the gospel when people are looking at your life, especially if they know you're a Christ follower? Philippians verse 12 says this, I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me, Paul is saying, what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel. Do you think in those terms, church? What can I do today that's going to help advance the gospel? In my sphere of influence, in my recreating, in my leisure, in my work, in my school, what's going to advance the gospel? Because what you do today, this side of heaven, matters for eternity. I want to encourage you to think about that. So here's four observations that I think Paul is saying to us this morning. The first, I'm not going to lose my joy over suffering. Paul knows something about suffering. Just read the New Testament and the narrative and the things that have happened to Paul. He's saying, I'm not going to let it steal my joy. Even in the difficult times, in the hard times, I'm not going to. Why? Well, look at the passage. The gospel is advancing. It's moving forward. It's not shrieking back. It's not being stifled. And God's kingdom is being advanced. And then he says, I want you to know. What it really means is listen up, pay attention. When you read scripture, you say, hey, sit up straight, listen to this. What has happened to me? So what has happened to Paul? Well, in Acts 21, you can read what has happened to Paul. He's falsely accused. How many of you have been falsely accused? Raise your hand. Like, that's not fair. You complain about it. Okay, so he's been falsely accused. How many? Don't raise your hand on this one. How many have been arrested? Don't raise your hand. He's been arrested in Jerusalem. How many have been beaten? No, I mean really beaten. Not disciplined, but beaten. He's been beaten. He implores that he was a Roman citizen. He's like telling them, hey, look, it, you can't do this. I'm a citizen of Rome. And then he's sent to Felix the governor. And then there's a plot to assassinate him. I don't think there's ever been a plot to assassinate me. Thank goodness, right? So they're trying to kill him. So now he's guarded by 200 soldiers, 70 horsemen, 200 spearmen waiting for trial. And so Paul says, I am not going to lose my joy over that because what has happened to me, Paul, has really advanced the gospel. Paul had this perspective. You know, friends, he persecuted the church. He hated the church. And then, on the road to what? Thank you. Is your church named after that? Like you're on a journey? And God can pluck you from the depths of your destruction of where you're headed and say, look, why are you doing this, Paul? Why are you persecuting me? And then Paul's blind. Okay, you know, that's just an amazing transformation. So when I look at Paul, and I look at how hard Paul was and how much he hated the church, and then I work with people, not in Converge, but when I associate with people that are hard-hearted, and some of you know what I'm about to say. Maybe you live with that person. Maybe they're a family member. You're like, I don't think Jesus could ever save them. They're just too far gone. They're hard. Remind yourself that God can do the amazing thing, and he did that to Paul. So advance the gospel. It's this idea that territory is being advanced. It's moving to areas that have previously not been occupied by the gospel. Friends, why do you think we do missions? Because there's parts of the world that have never heard the name of Jesus Christ. Never even heard the name of Jesus Christ. We can't fathom that. Some of you were Lutherans, Catholics, Methodists, Presbyterians, Baptists. Like, we're raised with Christ around us. Now, whether you follow Christ, that's a different story. There's a lot of church people that don't know and follow Christ. Amen? That's why new churches are so important to start. So advancing the gospel, look at verse 13. So that it has become known throughout the whole imperial guard and to all the rest that my imprisonment is for Christ. Man, talk about a great perspective. Like I'm retired law enforcement, so I've taken people to prison, I've taken people to jail, but I've never heard someone say, hey, my imprisonment is for Christ. I've never heard that in 24 years of being a cop. If you look at Acts 28:30-31, he says, he lived there, Paul lived there for 2 whole years at his own expense and welcomed all who came to him, proclaiming the kingdom of God and teaching about the Lord Jesus Christ with all, say the word, what's the word? Boldness. And without hindrance. Paul's chained to a Roman guard 24/7, and he's making the most out of every opportunity. He's saying, I'm going to use these chains. I'm going to use my circumstances. I'm going to use the valley of life, the most terrible thing I'm going through. That situation is going to reach people that would otherwise not be reached. That's why we started this city's cop church in October, to reach the first responders that are totally nicked up. There's biker churches. There's a cowboy church up in northern Minnesota trying to reach that demographic. You know, Pastor Luke had a vision to plant this church. And a whole lot of people were behind that, praying and encouraging and saying, you can do it. And then you look at Philippians 1:13, throughout the whole Imperial Guard, it's the unbelieving world. Do you know that Christianity and us Christians are being marginalized, being ignored? Do you know that? Can you raise your hand? Do you know that? Do you not know that? Okay, well, we have not done a good job in loving our neighbor and our community. So when you have opportunities to, like, hey, how do we reach more people? What about the youth in our schools? How do we reach them? And so my encouragement to you is begin to pray, step into that mess. I don't know what it looks like for your community. There's a whole lot of wayward children out there, whatever age group that may entail. The whole unbelieving world. And then you look at Paul's comment about, you know, my imprisonment is for Christ. There's fellow inmates that he's able to witness to. I know a pastor who spent 16 those years, 5 of those years were in solitary confinement. This guy was a bad dude. He ran gangs in San Francisco. He's an amazing guy, and God grips him in prison, and he starts a church a few years ago. And I've met him about 4 times. He is fired up with the gospel in Florida just a few months ago, and I said, hey, Ray, let me get my retirement badge, and we'll get a photo together. And this guy's a big Hispanic dude. And he's like, bro, we'll do post that on Facebook. Otherwise, they lose all sorts of street cred. Like, oh, I don't think that way. He's trying to reach former gang members with the gospel. I can't do that. And so God saves him through his imprisonment, and now he's got a ministry. I have a ministry to law enforcement because I know that language and I know how to talk to them. You may have some other thing. You know, I tell people, find other people that like to do what you do. It's golfing, it's fishing, it's hunting, it's, you fill in the blank for you. And then try to meet in a connection, in a friendship way without broadcasting. You know, being preaching. So when Luke introduces me at a preacher, no one likes getting preached at, right? So don't preach at these people. Just be friends to them. So then look at Philippians 1:14. It says this, and most of the brothers, having become confident in the Lord, see, they're putting their confidence in Christ by my imprisonment. Like, okay, God's doing something to you, Paul, and much more bold to speak the word without fear. Can I just have you meditate on that for a minute? Are you intimidated about being bold about your faith and your relationship with Christ? Because I think the dark side is not fearful or shameful about being bold about their side. Would you hear, you know what I'm talking about? There's a lot of stuff you see on television, you're like, that is not from Christ. That is dark, evil stuff. What about you changing the narrative and saying, hey, you know, why do you think you believe that? Because my God is not like that. I had a conversation with the paramedic last week, and he and I have really developed a friendship, and he's in a tough spot. This guy sees so much trauma in the Twin Cities as a medic, as a paramedic. And so we get to talk through things. And one of the things he said this past week on Tuesday, he said, well, you know, I know where I'm going. Now, I would say this. About 3 months ago, he said, I'm going to hell. Have you ever had anyone say that to you? You know, my constant response when someone says that, I say, that's why God put me in your life. I don't know what God's going to do, but I don't want you to go to hell, and Jesus doesn't want you to go to hell. And I told this guy, I said, I will drag you by the boots in heaven. I want him to know how much I care for him. So he tells me this past week, well, you know, I know where I'm going. I'm like, whoa, what does that mean? He goes, well, you know, I've done some good. I said, really? So you think because you've done some good, that means you know you're going to hell? And he kind of smiled. He said, well, you know, the Bible says when you do for the least of these, it's as if you've done unto me. And he said that to me because he's done a lot of good stuff and he cares for people. I said, yeah, but here's the deal. We can't do enough to save ourselves. That is why Christ came to this planet to redeem us, to die on the cross, to take away the sin penalty that is rightly ours. That's one part of Easter. But the other part is he rose again. He's the only deity, the only God that ever rose from the death. And we get to share in that. And I did, respectfully, I asked him, I said, hey, can I just push back on you a little bit? And he kind of smiled. And I think I planted a seed. Because if you think you can save yourself to get to heaven, that is not true. You need Jesus, period. Amen? And then Paul's talking about most of the brothers, they're empowered to be bold, to have courage. And boldness is action, it's not passive. So I hope you're leaning into that in your life. And Paul sees his suffering as a great impact for the kingdom. People are responding. They're watching Paul. Is his faith real? People are doing that to you and me, by the way. Is your faith real? We have a lady in her church. She's in her 70s. 2 weeks ago, she just got diagnosed with Lou Gehrig's disease. And I called her up that day. She's crying. I said, oh, Linda, I'm going to pray. We're going to pray for you. We had her come up that Sunday night. We laid hands on her. We're praying for a healing. We're asking God to heal, but we're asking God that his will would be communicated and done, that his will would be evident to all. I'm praying that she gets healed. But her attitude is, you know, if I live, that's great, but I know where I'm going. She doesn't want to die. But she's prepared to go because she's submitted her life to Christ. And that's a beautiful thing. So here's, you know, one of the things that Paul is saying is, I'm not going to lose my joy over my suffering. And I see that in many people that I have contact with. The next one is this. The next observation. Paul is saying, I'm not going to lose my joy over other servants. You know, look at verse 15. It says, some indeed preach Christ out of envy and rivalry, but others from goodwill. Satan's trap in the church is comparison. Like we're going to compare one another. We should not do that. Some of you don't lose your joy over the circumstance. You lose your joy over other people. Come on, let me see a smile. Come on. You know what I'm talking about. It's not the circumstances, people that trip you up. So Paul's saying some have bad motives. There's envy. There's jealousy. And I think sometimes God is using their life in a powerful way. I'm kind of envious of that. Well, don't. Why is she getting that opportunity? Why is he able to do that? And Paul says not only are their motives out of envy, quite frankly, out of rivalry. And rivalry, quite frankly, is relational conflict. It's competition. And it's usually stemmed in pride. So as you dream about being used by God, and there's places that Emmaus that God wants to use you, just step into that. Hey, how can you use me? By the way, this Linda that has ALS, Every Sunday night when we meet the first and third Sunday night. You know what she says? Every night. Thank you for letting me be a part of this. What an awesome, awesome attitude. And I'm not trying to guilt you, so I'm not guilting you, but I am guilting you, okay? So listen to this. Have you ever gone up to Pastor Luke and Renee and said, thank you for letting me be a part of this? It's a different attitude, isn't it? I bet you puts a smile on his face. So don't do it today. Take a note and then do it in 2 weeks or 1 week or whatever. Watch out for those people that want to come up to you and tell you what God is trying to teach you. Okay, sometimes those people have bad motives, but sometimes there's good motives. Look at verse 16. The latter do it out of love. The latter do it out of love. They're preaching out of love. They love Paul. Their attitude is, hey, we can't let him down. He's in prison. We need to slack and advance the kingdom. Verse 16, knowing that I'm put here for the defense of the gospel. And Paul says, I'm placed here on assignment. Do you realize that when you go through suffering, that's a blessing and an honor? We don't like suffering, but the Bible clearly teaches when you go through suffering, you become more like Jesus. Luke, do you tell your people that you want them to become more like Jesus? He's shaking his head. He wants you to become more like Jesus. Why? Because he's on a journey. Renee's on a journey. Their five boys are on a journey to become more like Jesus. And Paul is saying, hey, look at my suffering. I'm advancing the kingdom, and I'm actually, when I'm suffering, I'm becoming more like Jesus. And verse 17, it says, the former proclaimed Christ out of selfish ambition. It's not sincere, but sincerely, but thinking to inflict me imprisonment. I don't meet a lot of those people that are vindictive and mean and are just trying to hurt me. I don't have a lot of those people in my life, but they're out there. And by the way, Satan doesn't like church plants and he doesn't like this church, so he's going to try to throw things at you. You should be aware of that. Sometimes we just get stuck. I don't know if I ever told this to Luke, but there's a book called The Well-Intended Dragon that every pastor should read. People that come into churches, they seem nice, but deep down they've got a motive, and it's not to bless the church, it's to hurt the church. And sometimes Paul is saying this, sometimes people have bad motives. So you have to be aware of that. And Paul says, notice their intent. It's not genuine, and they stir up trouble. Everybody's going to go through hardships. And some, it's because they've caused it themselves. Sometimes you go through hardships because of your poor choices. And I cause a lot of trouble. Just ask my wife of 38 years. I cause most of my problems. It's not the devil, and it's not other people. It's I just have made bad decisions. But God wants to advance the kingdom through you and me, and that's really the good news. So we should assess our life situations. When we're going through trouble and difficulty, we should say, am I going through this because of some sin or some poor decision? Or is God trying to discipline me and correct me? And are there people that I've led into my life that I trust to say, hey, this is what's going on in your life. You're kind of wayward. And that's what is beautiful about a local church and about this church. Third observation is this. Our joy is in the daily message of Christ. And the key is daily message. It's unstoppable for this stressed out world we live in. Philippians 1:18 says, what then, Paul says, only that in every way, whether in pretest or in truth, Christ is proclaimed, and I rejoice in that. That is the priority of our life, friends. It is proclaiming the gospel of Christ. Sometimes I'm asked, hey, what do you think about this church, that church? What do you think about that pastor, ministry? Are they proclaiming the gospel of Christ? Is it redemption through Jesus Christ? Are they talking about sin and the penalty of sin that rightly we deserve? Do they believe that the only hope for this fallen world is what Christ accomplished on the cross? Do they believe that? If they believe that, then we're for them and they're for us. And then we can just end it right there. Is Christ preached? That's what we want to know. Fourth observation is this, as we're ending and rounding the corner for this. I'm not going to lose my joy over the uncertain future. I think today in 2022, in my lifetime, it's a really uncertain future, right? Like, talking about gas prices, talking about economy, we're talking about everything that's going on in the world, Ukraine, Russia, there's so much uncertainty. You can decide, I'm not going to lose my joy because of that future. And there's a lot of people in our culture that are dealing with extreme stress and anxiety and worrying. Our kids are truly stressed out about their future. We've got to help them. I'm not going to get stressed out about everything because quite frankly, there's so much I can't control. Here's the bottom line. I'm not going to lose my joy over anything. Can you say that, church? Can you choose today, I'm not going to lose my joy, and I'm going to ask God in heaven to give me the indwelling of the Holy Spirit who fills me with joy, and I'm going to ask for that every morning when I wake up to live this life joy-filled. That is the absolute truth, because when we meet Christ face to face, there's a few questions he's probably going to ask us. And I want to be able to go, you know what? It was a hard thing. It was a hard, difficult journey that I've experienced. But I still have a smile on my face. I'm still living for Christ, and he fills me with joy. Let's stand and pray. Sam, are you going to do a closing song? Outstanding. Father God in heaven, thank you for this morning. Thank you for what Paul is experiencing to press on into us in this short little letter in Philippians. Lord, it's easy for us to walk out of here and go, okay, well, we talked about joy. What does it matter? Lord, it matters because we need to become more like Jesus. And although there was stress and anxiety and difficulty when Jesus was headed to the cross, we think of the Garden of Gethsemane where he's praying, he's distraught. We're thinking of the temptation in the wilderness for 40 days. Every emotion I know that Jesus experienced. But he didn't let the circumstances derail his joy. He didn't let his future destroy his joy. So Lord, would you help us today to put on joy, to become more like Jesus? Would you help us to live that out, not only today on Sunday, but Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and the rest of the week, and the rest of the month, and the rest of the years? Thank you for Emmaus Community Church. Lord, bless them. I pray that you would expand their territory, that this summer would be a year of building and retooling and advancing, getting ready for, as Luke said, the ministry season in September, Lord, but I pray that you would draw more people in. Lord, thank you that we get to do this. We don't have to do it. Thank you that we can be a blessing to this church and we can see your kingdom come. We pray all this. Everyone said.